Dear Dave and Tom, I'm writing to you both as you've each expressed an interest in Amy's artificial intelligence information gathering project. We've managed to find a professor in the topic, and he's very keen to share with you what he knows and answer any questions you may have about AI and or robotics. As you know, there is a lot of confusion, as well as some understandable concern about AI, just as there used to be about information technology. We'd obviously like to know if those fears are well-founded, and if they are, then we'd like to know what we should be doing about addressing them. I don't want this to be a long email, and I'll arrange for the time, date, and address details of Professor Clive to be forwarded on to you shortly. Looking forward to your findings. Chris, Head of IT's AI Information Acquisition.
This is welcoming, I must say.
Hey there, are you Frank from Amy?
Yes, that's right. Are you Dave, then?
Yes, looks like we've drawn the short straw for this AI discovery mission, eh?
Looks like it. What's your experience of artificial intelligence so far?
Not much, to be honest. I've seen a few YouTube videos, and there's a lot of talk around the office about what it could mean in terms of changes at work. I'm not sure I'm terribly keen on it.
I know what you mean. I've seen videos where people seem to think it's the best thing since sliced bread, and others that say it's the end of the world.
What do you think, then?
Me? I think that it's a tool like a hammer or a word processor. People use tools to get things done. Tools don't create the future, but they do help shape it. Can you imagine a life without your smartphone or the internet? I think we're going to see a world where artificial intelligence unifies a lot of technology and understanding. Or millions of killer robots out to destroy mankind. All that, of course. But I don't think so.
So, do you think this is the place, then?
No, that's it over there, I think.
Oh, thank goodness for that.
I suppose we'd better ring the doorbell.
Hello, gentlemen. The professor has been expecting you. From what I know of you, you must be Frank and David. Am I correct?
Yes, that's right. I'm Frank. This is Dave.
Will more of you be joining us today?
No, it's just us two today.
That's fine. The professor and I both enjoy more intimate groups. They can be so much more personal. Please stand by while I open the doors. Just a moment. Just a moment. The doors are now open. Please come in.
Thank you, Pal 9000.
Welcome to Aperture Science. We think of ourselves as a pinhole camera looking into the quantum realm of artificial intelligence and cyber robotics. Please make yourselves comfortable while I summon the professor for you. Please wait here and feel free to observe the information screens while you wait. I'm sure the professor will not detain you long.
Oh, look. It looks as if there's a presentation on the history and growth of AI here. Shall we give it a go?
Go for it, Frank.
Artificial intelligence is a broad topic, but is a technology commonly used in people's homes, on their phones, and in industry. It can be used to create images, videos, sounds, musical compositions, and written work. We're going to start by looking at AI-driven written content and reveal how text generators like ChatGPT, which underpins a great deal of Microsoft's Copilot software, actually work. Artificial intelligence is not a particularly good description of what goes on inside the workings of ChatGPT and similar programs. Perhaps a better term would be intelligent guessing. Anyone who has ever texted with a mobile phone will know how reliable text prediction and autocorrection can be. Mobile phones are equipped with a small dictionary and a narrow understanding of how language works. In this way, it reads what you are typing and tries to guess what the most likely word you might like to reach for will be. Any spelling mistakes you might make might be correctly identified and changed, or they may be replaced by an entirely inappropriate word choice selection. Your mobile phone's ability to correctly anticipate the right word is limited by several factors, including its processing power, its limited dictionary, the program that instructs its understanding of your language, and more besides. Modern AI platforms take advantage of vastly more powerful processors which are not available to your mobile phone, and have dedicated training scripts to improve its understanding of your language, what it is you're asking of it, and how it might best reply to your request for information. This kind of AI relies on something called a large language model, or LLM for short. LLMs are very important, so try to keep this concept in your memory, as it will come up a good deal in conversations about AI. An LLM is a language database which is trained on all aspects of language, and a large part of understanding language is having a complete and thorough grasp of linguistics. This is what we're going to talk about next. Linguistics is the study of language and comprises the following concepts. Phonetics, which is the study of how sounds of speech are produced and perceived. Phonology, which is the study of sound patterns and changes in that sound. Morphology is the study of word structure, or how words are made. Syntax is the study of sentence structure, or the correct order of subject, verb, and adjective, for example. Semantics is concerned with linguistic meaning and is a complicated subject in its own right. Pragmatics regards how language is used in context, as words such as you can differ depending upon the context in which the word is used. You might mean you, the person, or you, the group, and this can be confusing, even to adult humans at times. Historical linguistics studies how language has changed and developed over time. Think of the word sick. Usually this word is connected with people suffering from a physical ailment, but in some circumstances, people use the word sick to mean that's really terrific. Awful used to mean full of awe, but it is now used to indicate something tragic is happening. Sociolinguistics is the study of the relationship between language and society. Computational linguistics is the study of how computers can process human language. Our list here concludes with psycholinguistics, which is how humans acquire and use language. But there is much more to language than simply understanding the mechanics and laws which govern commonplace parlance. On a daily basis, we employ jokes, irony, sarcasm, and often don't say what we mean. Take, for example, the phrase, "I don't like that car." Conversationally, people hearing this may take this to mean, "I actively dislike that car," though the speaker may only mean they would not choose that car, or perhaps, even more subtly, that they do not care for the way that particular car is driven. Context, intonation, and body language help humans make the best sense of a conversation and what it is that is most likely being implied or directly expressed. When a visitor in your home asks, "Can I have a cup of tea?" the reply might strictly be yes, but the chances are that the guest is asking if you could make them one, or, if they are a particularly familiar guest, perhaps asking permission to make themselves one. In normal conversation, inference, hints, and social cues play a large part in our intuitive understanding of each other's communication. So exceptions, wordplay, and poorly articulated word structures all have to be allowed for when an artificial intelligence is asked to make sense of what is being written into it. AI's mastery of linguistics and grammar creates what is called a language model. The larger the model, the greater the power and accuracy of the model. A large language model, then, will understand subtleties and nuances in language that a smaller language model, such as on your phone, cannot. How does this all work in practice? Imagine you feed an LLM a sentence. The language model will analyze the sentence and examine the order of words, their meanings, and how they fit together. Then the language model will generate a prediction or a continuation of the sentence that makes sense based on its understanding of the language. It will weave words together, creating a response that seems like a human might have created it. Linguistics is key to instructing programs like ChatGPT, so that you get what you want. These written instructions are called prompts and constructing a prompt is called prompt engineering. Understanding the nuances of language and how it is used in different contexts is crucial for crafting effective prompts. Also, knowing how to use a grammar or language structure that is universally used will result in the AI system returning the most accurate results. That said, through trial and error, you'll usually get quite satisfactory results for your everyday use. In 1964, the first computer to attempt conversational skills was called Eliza. This was an early natural language processing computer. Natural language processing, or NLP for short, is another important concept in AI's comprehension and another three-letter acronym you'll want to keep in mind for later use. Eliza's party trick was in mimicking psychotherapists. A person could communicate through the keyboard with Eliza. Of course, Eliza had no empathy or really any interest in the patient, but to the person communicating with Eliza, it felt very encouraging and encouraged a great deal of self-analysis by asking the right question and developing a conversation, which was very much patient-led. For example, if the patient said, "I feel sad," Eliza would come back with, "Why do you think you feel sad?" Eliza worked on a very small language model. It had to. Its processing power and memory were scarce resources. Years later, in the 1970s, a breakthrough in object recognition was made, which in combination with a smaller large language model was able to recognize simple building blocks of the sort infant children still play with today. The program was called SHRDLU, which doesn't stand for anything, but is named after an optimized keyboard array. In truth, the building blocks never existed outside the imagination of SHRDLU's mind, but an operator could see the building blocks on a screen. Here's part of a conversation an operator had with SHRDLU.
"The blue pyramid is nice."
"I understand."
"I like blocks which are red, but I don't like anything which supports a pyramid."
"I understand."
"Do I like the box?"
"No."
"Do I like anything in the box?"
"Yes, two things, the blue block and the blue pyramid."
"Will you please stack up both of the red blocks and either a red cube or a pyramid?"
"Okay."
"Which cube is sitting on the table?"
"The large green one which supports the red pyramid."
"Is there a large block behind a pyramid?"
"Yes, three of them, a large red one, a large green cube, and the blue one."
"Put a small one onto the green cube which supports a pyramid."
"Okay."
"Put the littlest pyramid on top of it."
"Okay."
"How did you do it?"
"By putting a large red block on the table, then letting go of it, then letting go of that cube, then putting the red cube on that cube, then letting go of that cube."
"How many objects did you touch while you were doing it?"
"Four of them."
"There were five blocks to the left of the box then?"
"No, only four of them. The red, two large green cubes, and a large red block."
Although SHRDLU was not a language model, it laid the foundation for machines to understand human language. However, the actual language models began in 2010 with the rise of deep learning and neural networks, resulting in the powerful GPT, also known as Generative Pre-trained Transformer. GPT was designed to revolutionize the field of language. OpenAI introduced the first version of GPT in 2018, which was trained on an extensive volume of text data. This included books, articles, and a significant portion of the internet. The model absorbed vast amounts of knowledge, making it a formidable tool for natural language processing. GPT-1 was a taste of things to come, an impressive language model, but small compared to its descendants that we use today. As time passed, the momentum continued with the arrival of GPT-2 in 2019, followed by GPT-3 in 2020. This was a titan among language models, equipped with many parameters,
over 175 billion, to be precise. GPT-3 amazed the world with its exceptional capability to comprehend, respond, and produce imaginative writing pieces. The release of GPT-3 signified a milestone in the development of language models and AI. Currently, we have GPT-4, on which Microsoft Copilot is based. It has been trained on the whole internet, rather than outdated large datasets. Regarding language models and AI, we are only at the beginning of a journey that could take us to places we have yet to imagine. Learning how to harness this tool is an intelligent move for anyone today. This concludes this video tutorial on a brief history of AI. I hope you enjoyed learning about the importance of linguistics, the role of large language models, and natural language processing, as well as the history of AI computing functions.